That's for last, but I fear that's not going to be true. Give this a shot. I was asked via email to give some funny stories about Tom. And unfortunately, only one I could think of was a fishing story in the early versions of Sargent's fishing career that I cannot talk about over dinner. So I'm going to save it for years. Instead of stories that involve Tom, involving Tom directly, at least, what I'm going to do is talk about stories that involve Tom, at least kind of ex post, in the sense of it requires a sense of humor on my part to fully address some of these events of my life. There's been lots of discussions about how the, you know, the wonderful friendly atmosphere towards graduate students, and this is certainly the case. I've watched Tom's approach to graduate students evolve dramatically over the years, and it's just amazing to see the nurturing that takes place. Well, I was in the version, I was in Minnesota between 74 and 78, and I can assure you that things were different then. I had three people on my committee. They were Neil Wallace, Chris Sims, and Tom Sargent. And I have memories of each, I have distinct memories of all three of them in critical parts of my career. I started off with Neil Wallace. I was trying to think about where to go to graduate school. I was, you know, like many others, I was told, well, you got to go to MIT, and then I didn't get into MIT, so now I had to pick between Minnesota, Yale, and Chicago. Chicago was filled with right-wing fascists, so I couldn't go there. So at that point in time, Neil's in charge of the admissions, and so I call and I talk to him, and I talk on the phone. None of this flying to places and victory tours, none of that stuff. And so Neil says, "Do you really want to come here?" That was Neil the trumpet. My reaction to this was, I thought I did before this phone call. But it was very lucky for me that I decided to go anyway. So next, Chris Sims, the time of the job market, I go in, I talk to Chris about strategies to the job market, and Chris looks at me and he says, "It's a good thing you've got a lot of interviews, because you look better on paper than in person." Reminiscent of the Lloyd Benstrom was his name, and the Dan Quayle debate, which probably many of you don't know. I go in and I talk to Tom before the job market, and he points out, "Well, you're no Rob Townsend." I said, "Yeah, you're right." But I'm not sure what it has to do with his insight. Tom said it very politely, but I kind of got the impression that you have to understand at that point in time, there were kind of Rob was one of two great heroes to the graduate program, because John, you know, Rob and John Gavick, you were the big stars that there were 2 years ahead of us in cohort. So that was Tom's first attempt, I guess, to cheer me up. the second one was there was at the time that job offers were supposed to be coming in. I was at the Minneapolis Fed, and after lunch, these notes get posted. Notes getting out if you have a phone message, a key phone message over lunch or something. And at this point in time, I come back from lunch, and there's this note on the door, and it's from Harvard. It says, "Don't call us, we'll call you." A little bit of effort, I was able to figure out the source of that note, and you can guess who it was. So I've got one other. I can see Tom getting upset over here. I think I'm going to be in trouble really soon. There's one other interesting experience that I had that Tom claims complete innocence for, but you can make your own decision on this. It was shortly after that I had gone, I was in the transition between Carnegie Mellon and Chicago. And Tom calls me up and he says, "I can't make it to the Latin American meetings of the Econometric Society. Would you go and present our paper for us?" And the paper we had going at the time was this super high-tech paper using so-called flashy factors. I mean, you think matrix Riccati equations are ugly. Blaschke factors are interesting, I guess. But anyway, they weren't exactly the hot topic of the day. And so anyway, I said, sure, you know, I'm this young guy. Here's this great opportunity. I get to go to the Latin American meetings. And I think Jose may have been at those meetings. So I show up at those meetings. And this person, I think it's maybe for the finance minister or something, starts bugging me. So where's Tom Sargent? I said, I don't think Tom Sargent's coming. He said, well, where's Tom Sargent? Well, this guy had been brought in to introduce Tom in a really mad, big speech. I go into an audience, you know, I'm expecting some like small group of 20 people to present some highly technical paper. I go in an audience between like 100 to 200 people. I have a very tiny blackboard. And this poor guy coming from the Mexican government, having no idea who I am, he introduces me as the famous Swedish economist. So, courtesy of Tom Sargent, I became a famous Swedish economist. This event has remained etched in my brain because in the audience at this point in time were people like Jim Heckman and Buzz Brock. They were pretty much rolling in the aisles, finding great humor out of all of this. Jim was kind enough the next day to haul me off to the pyramids because he thought I needed to be taken someplace else to recover. Tom told me that he had no idea that this was going to happen. So let me get back to some other stuff. On Monday, when I heard about the award to Tom and Chris, I was incredibly excited. And then there's a putt. And then I thought of something else, too. I said, you know, Tom and I are supposed to be getting this paper ready for Carnegie Rochester. If there's ever a time we're going to fall, this is the chance. Well, last night, Tom and I are exchanging emails about the fight. You know, trying to get some draft ready for the Carnegie Rochester conference. So that's just vintage Tom. I mean, he's the scholar all the time. There's probably nothing that will disrupt his kind of scholarship ambition. And it's just truly amazing. I think I've been kind of incredibly lucky to have both Tom and Chris as mentors. In the 70s, they sketched out this really, in very distinct ways, visions about how to use economic models to kind of restrict and interpret time series in kind of very different, distinct, innovative ways that are complementary. But I think it was just an incredible vision that I said that's had a huge impact on me. So the fact that I have two of those guys as my mentors has just been kind of the best thing that could have ever happened. People have talked about Tom's amazing list of graduate students, including the ones that showed up, and it's truly impressive. I've been lucky enough to have a lot of good graduate students over the years, and a very high fraction of them are going to cite Tom Sargent as the one for key inspiration. So his influence extends way beyond his own students, and as has been suggested by others. I'm not going to go up to the numbers that Chari mentioned, but I think certainly have personal testimony for a whole lot of young scholars that have just gotten tremendous benefit from him. Over the years, Tom has been just an amazing co-author. He's the same energy many people describe that he would project on the students. He kind of projects in terms of co-author relationships. He has very innovative ways to think about things. High energy. It's been truly a great opportunity to me to kind of grow up in my career being associated with Tom. Here's a final toast to the great scholar Tom Sargent.